Amen. All right, we just want to get into the Word of God. I want to just announce the title that we've been talking from. We've been talking from six steps. Everybody just says six steps. Amen. Our six steps or six keys to staying focused spiritually. And I want to just kind of reiterate some of them. Number one, self-restraint or self-discipline. Very important to being able to stay on track. Amen. Self-discipline and self-restraint. Summertime, we have the picnics and parties and family get-togethers, and the emphasis centers around eating. Amen. I want to also announce that this coming Wednesday night, we're going to have our focus on self-restraint and nutrition. Usually, periodically, we do that. We're going to have a special person to come and share in that particular area. And she's going to be sharing some things that will relate to your potential in restoring your health, And you need to be here because this person has experienced many, many, many miraculous results in working with people to help them to get their health restored back to its original state. And I haven't met a person in Tulsa that have seen so many people healed just by following certain dietary laws and certain laws that pertain to the laws of nature. It's going to be miraculous, and I feel that this is going to be a time that you can invite friends and relatives. And I'm going to be traveling a couple of months, just doing some nutritional presentations up in North Carolina. It's very key. People are crying out for directions and help and support and being able to overcome a whole lot of things that pertains to diets and unrestraint in eating and self-discipline. So there are some miraculous things that's going to be shared on Wednesday night. And one thing that's going to be shared is how people are overcoming cancer. Amen. So it's going to be unusual. So you want to be here. And also, I'm going to pass out, the Lord says the same, a handout on expanding your capability to believe. I'm going to be talking about some things that will really help you to think bigger, believe bigger, and experience greater results. So we are approaching the challenges of life, especially in the area of finances and physical health, from two perspectives, from the perspective of spiritual, and getting your belief and strengthen. And that's, I'm going to speak this Sunday or next Sunday on one factor that really helps you to expand your believing, because if you can expand your believing, amen, that means that faith is acting on what you believe. That means that your faith will work better. So we're going to be focusing on the spiritual as well as the physical. All right, number two, what we have shared in the past, persistence in prayer. Just say persistence in prayer. How many of you like to pray? I'm going to pray at home, pray in your car, pray in the spirit, pray in the shower. From the rising of the sun till the going down of the same, the scripture says, men ought to what? Praise the name of the Lord. So we want to understand the importance of being persistent in prayer, because the effectual fervent prayer of the righteous avails much. And one component I have found in prayer that I really, really, really like, and I'm going to try to sell you on it too, that means giving thanks.
Amen.
I mean, just get crazy, you know. Somebody say, I'm a fool for Christ's sake.
Yes, amen.
And how many, somebody's fool. Everybody is somebody's fool. So I'd rather be a fool for Christ than a fool for anybody else. How many can say amen?
Amen.
So when you begin to talk about rejoicing and thanking God before you even receive the blessing that you are praying for, I mean, just go crazy. You know, when you go crazy rejoicing and praising God and acting all out of sort for things that God has promised you, yet you haven't received them, but yet you are mighty glad. Amen. And you believe within your heart that those blessings are already yours. Amen. So I want to get you in the habit of getting rid of your long faces, sad looks, your sad countenance, and put some, you know, only take 13 muscles to smile. Take 64 to frown. Y'all knew that. So it's a lot easier to what? Rejoice than it is to what? Be down, or to be sad, or to be discouraged. Amen. So that's the key that I want to magnify. We have to focus on the importance of rejoicing and praising God for whatever you're believing Him for, right in the midst of what you're going through. That's the thing that brings you through. Amen. The faith that you release as you rejoice, thanking God for the end result. See, God wants you to see the end. Amen. Amen. The end of the matter. Amen. At the beginning point. He wants you to see the end results of whatever. Amen. Just tell somebody, say, God wants you to see the end results. Amen. And that's what you do when you begin to rejoice and begin to internalize and begin to verbalize and to get excited. Then God gives you a picture. He will give you a physical view of the thing that you are believing Him for. Amen. How many want all of your bills liquidated?
Amen.
How many want to be debt free? Amen. Find your scripture. Praise God for, amen, for the ability. Amen. You might want to sign up for Sister Jessica's class too. Gotta help. Amen. But you're going to have to praise God and see the thing that you're believing for has done. And praise God in the midst of your believing. Amen. So that God can actually bring the thing that you desire into fruition. Amen. I tell you, it's nothing like rejoicing in the midst of a problem.
Yes.
It's difficult to do sometimes, but sometimes you have to force yourself to what? Rejoice when you're going through hardships and problems and difficult situations. If you can train your spirit to rejoice, you'll never be defeated. Scripture says, if we delight in the Lord, He'll give us the desires of our heart. Amen. Scripture also says that, fear not, O ye land, rejoice and be glad. Be glad. And God will do great things.
Amen.
I like a God that does great things. How many can say amen? Hallelujah. But we have to get rid of these sad faces. Amen. Get your mind off of what you don't want and get it on what you want God to do and what you're believing for. Amen. So the third thing that we have talked about is that these are keys to staying focused spiritually. And the third one is to stay humble. Do not get caught up or be desirous of vain glory. Everybody just says stay humble. And the scripture that we read for that was 1 Peter 5, verses 5 through 7, and James 4, verse 6. And I just want to recap those scriptures because there are three great blessings promised if you would stay humble. There are three great blessings. How many want a great blessing? Amen. Just one or two people want to see. You always get up, end up with what you want. If you don't want anything, you won't get anything. The Bible says he feels the hungry with what? Good things. He feels the empty, the hungry with good things. And those that got all that they want, he sends them away empty. Amen. So you have to be, you have to want stuff and want it real bad. All right, 1 Peter 5, 7. These are scriptures that will give you three things that God will do if you can meet the criteria that he sets for being humble. The criteria for humility, if you can meet those standards. Okay, 1 Peter 5, it says this. 1 Peter 5, 5. Likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves unto the elder. Yea, all of you, be subject one to another. And this is talking about submission. You know, the scripture says that if we submit to God, then we can resist the devil and he will flee. So submitting to God is submitting to the elders, submitting to one another, and being clothed with humility. Okay, it says, for God resisteth the proud and giveth grace to the humble. Amen. Be clothed with humility. For God resisteth the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Amen. Verse 6 says, humble yourselves therefore under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due season. Casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. Okay, so we see in that passage, let me just go further. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. Whom resist, steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. So you can see there that the ability to resist in verse 8 is contingent upon you being subject in verse 5. So if you submit to God, then God gives you the ability, you will have the ability to resist the devil. So the ability to resist the devil is directly tied to your submission to God, submitting to God. And when we say submit to God, it doesn't mean like some super duper people, you know, super sellers and the Holy Joes, and they say, well, I don't submit to nobody but Jesus. I don't obey nobody but Jesus. Amen. So that's, whenever people talk like that, you know they are kind of off. Because submission to God means you submit not only to his word, to his spirit, to Jesus, but you submit to what? Your pastor, your elders, your husband, your wife, and those that you are under. You have to submit across the board in order to be in subjection to the word of God. All across the board. Everybody just say, all across the board.
All across the board.
Amen. So that has a lot to do with your ability. You know, sometimes people say, I'm gonna kick the devil out of my house. They can just go through all of these actions and start kicking and say, devil, I kick you. I mean, just they kick their legs and amen, and call themselves hitting the devil in his behind, getting them out. But the devil ain't going nowhere if you are not submitted to God. Right, amen. So the ability to resist the devil and the authority, the ability to exercise dominion over the devil is about 90% of obedience. You got to be in compliance with God's word across the board. How many can say amen?
Amen.
The Bible says that you have a readiness. God, amen. This is, I'll just turn there. 2 Corinthians 10, it says that God will avenge all. He'll back you up in all of your endeavors, whatever you decree, whatever you establish, whatever you pray and believe, a demand done. He'll back you up, but it's only when your obedience is fulfilled. Only when your obedience is fulfilled. I want to read it so you will know that it's important for you to obey if you're going to deal with the devil. If you're going to, because the devil doesn't have to obey you if you are not in compliance with God's word. He doesn't have to. Amen. All right. It says, the weapons of our warfare, this is our 2 Corinthians 10, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. This is something that, you know, we have to do. And having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. So the word is not going to work, your authority won't work, your anointing is not going to work over the devil if you are not in harmony with God's word. Amen. That's when God's power, scripture says that we can decree things, and the things that we decree shall be what? Established. We can say to this mountain, be thou moved and cast into the sea, and don't doubt in your heart, but believe that those things that you say shall come to pass. How many know there's power in your words when you are walking in obedience to God's word? Amen. Amen. Jesus said, the words that I speak are spirit and they are what? Life. Yes. Amen. That's when you are walking in harmony with God's word. So don't look for God to back you up if you are not living according to his word. It only works. Everybody just say it only works.
It only works.
When you're walking in obedience.
Walking in obedience.
Amen. How many believe that?
Amen.
Amen. So the three things that we see in that first scripture, in 1 Peter 5, verses 5 through 7, that God promises to give you the ability to resist the devil when you are subject, when you are in submission to his will. Amen. You have power over the devil. Amen. Praise God. Okay, the second thing that we see in that passage is that God promises to, just go back there and look at it. It says that humble yourself, verse 6, this is still 1 Peter 5, it says, humble yourselves therefore under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due season. Amen. God promises to exalt you. How many want to be exalted?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So some of y'all do you know what I said? How many want to be exalted? Y'all know what exalted means?
Yeah.
That means a little thing.
Yeah.
Amen. God wants to what? Exalt you. Some say, well, I'm happy as I'm like I am. Amen. I'm happy just as happy with. Amen. Nothing happened with Jesus alone, sometimes people say. But I believe that God wants to exalt you. How many want to be exalted financially? Amen. We have three. So I'm saying, I got $500 a month, $700 a month. Amen. Praise God. Be just happy as you can be. Bless you. Right. Amen. Praise God. I applaud you. If you can, amen. Amen. But I believe God can do more. Amen. God will exalt you. Okay. Now, the best illustrations you could give for that is that men like that we've studied, like Joseph, they were very humble. Very humble. They didn't take credit for anything that God was doing through them. They trusted God to bring them out, whatever the devil tried to destroy them through. They always gave all of the credit, amen, the visions, the dreams, and all of the great abilities that were working through them. They always say that I'm not able to do this in myself. The interpretations and these abilities of to interpret dreams, they all came from God. Amen. And That's the thing that made them so great. One day, after being humble, you know how he submitted to Potiphar? Joseph did. And I mean, he submitted across the board. Did it so well until Potiphar saw his faithfulness, his diligence, and he saw that the favor of God was on his life. So he turned everything that pertained to his household over to Joseph, even his bank accounts. And whatever was done, amen, Joseph was the one that they had to go through. Amen. He was exalted. Even when he was lied on and they threw him in prison, right? And he was faithful there. Faithful, 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 faithful. And two men had dreams, and he was able to interpret the dreams. And he said that interpretation belongs to God. I can't do this. But there's a God in heaven that understands all secrets and dreams and visions.
Amen.
And his revelation, God gave him revelation. That was the thing that brought him out of prison. Although he was over all prisoners, he was exalted even in prison. You know, it's just like one of those, what kind of balls you have, you can put them under the water. What kind of balls you call those? Yeah, beach ball. You can just mash it down and force it under the water. But what happens? It pops right back up. Amen. That's the way it is when God places his favor on your life. People can knock you around, take you through changes, deny you your rights and privileges, and do everything imaginable to keep you from succeeding. But favor is God's ability released toward you that will cause you to exceed, amen, to succeed every time. God's favor released toward you. And how many know that, amen, Satan is always releasing his ability against you, trying to keep you what? Down. Amen. The scripture says that if God be for us, it doesn't matter who's against us. Amen. Praise God. How many know that God's favor, amen, praise God. How does that go? One day of favor, God's favor, is worth, amen, a whole year of labor. I guess you could say that. Hallelujah. One day of favor is worth thousands of days of what? Of labor. Amen. God can exalt you. Amen. How many know it's good to be exalted? If you're humble, God is going to what? He's going to exalt you. He's going to place you in a position where people have to look up to you. People have to respect you. Even some of your own enemies, people will have to bow down to you. Amen. Praise God. So you can see through the Bible that the purpose of submission is to make the way, to open the door for God to exalt you. Amen. For the devil to be subject to you. Amen. That happened. That happened every time if you submit to God. And the third thing, in the same passage, you'll see that that humility does. It says God resisted the proud, but he gives what? Grace to the humble. Grace is a big thing. It's a big thing. It's God's favor released toward you. It's God doing for you that nobody else, another amen, can do for you. It's the sum total of all of God's blessings released in your life. And you want to be under God's grace. You want to be positioned to receive God's grace. So all of these are benefits and blessings that God promised. You can turn over to James now. You can see the same provisions, James 4, verse 6. We can see the same thing. James 4, verse 6, it says, But he giveth more grace, wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace to the humble, giveth grace. Sometimes people call it God's unmerited favor. Sometimes people call it a working of God that brings you to a place where people are supernaturally inclined to respond to you favorably. You can see that in the life of Joseph and Daniel and all of these great men, that they had that mark of humility, and all of them went to the top. Amen. I don't know how many times Daniel was promoted. The first vision and dream that he was able to interpret, he was made third president of the entire kingdom. Just went from nothing, wow, to third position in the kingdom. The next time, he received another promotion, and he kept on receiving promotions until he became the first president. They had 120 of them, and he was the first president. He was over all of those 120 princes. But he never took credit for all that God did through him. He never boasted.